In this lecture, we would focus on India in the 18th century. Now, 18th century India was an interesting period of transition. And this was a transition from the medieval history to the modern history. That means, after the Mughal rule, how British or the British India rule started. And that is the period that we would understand. So, after the Mughals, the last Mughal, Aurangzeb, the last major ruler, Aurangzeb, was the one that we had studied in our last classes. Now we would understand after Aurangzeb how the Mughal empire actually started to decline. So Aurangzeb, after him there were four of his sons. His son Bahadur Shah I became the ruler. However, he was not conversant with the policies that were laid down by Aurangzeb. He was against the narrow defined policies of Aurangzeb, and he started to have his own system of ideology. Later on, it was Jahandar Shah, Farukh Siyar who came to power. Amongst these, there was Muhammad Shah, and during a period of Muhammad Shah, it was the invasion of Nadir Shah in India. Nadir Shah looted India. Nadir Shah came from Iran in 1739 and he looted India. The major areas where this happened was most of the territory that was occupied during the Mughal period. So if I look onto the map of India, the parts of India, parts of the present Pakistan and the parts of Afghanistan were under the rule of Aurangzeb. However, there were certain sections, as you can see here, which were left, and these were the rule of the Maratha Empire during that time. So if we focus on the issues that had been laid down after the Mughal Empire, there were numerous reasons which led to the decline of the Mughal Empire. The first important rule concept, as we can understand, were the next rulers were weak. The successors were weak. Why they were weak? Because they were not able to have unity. They were not good administrators, and they actually ran a puppet government. So the policy of friendship and peacemaking was the key idea. They did not had any idea about the process of administration. The second important reason for their failure was there was a lot of rivalry that happened between the nobles themselves. So they were not conversant with the other neighboring rulers, and they usually fought among themselves, and this was another factor that led to the downfall of Mughal Empire. The third and the very important factor was there was a crisis of Jagirdari system and Mansabdari system. Now, what was Jagirdari system? The officers were not given salaries. Rather than being given salary, they were given parcels of land. So that parcel of land was to be maintained, their troops to be maintained, the household expenses to be maintained based on that parcel of land, which was known as Jagir. So that Jagir was given. But over the years, what happened? There was crisis in the quality Jagir. The land was in paucity, and therefore this system could not pursue long. The next important system was the Mansabdari system. Mansabdari system was the administrative system, and as we said, the officers were given the jagirs and they had to maintain the household and the troops. And since the quality of the land deteriorated, there was paucity of the land. This led to the crisis in the Mansabdari system as well. So there was failure of the Jagirdari as well as the Mansabdari system. Now, besides this, there were numerous invasions that took place. The important invasions were by Nadir Shah from Iran, who took away the Kohinoor and the peacock throne, and then Ahmad Shah Abdali. Now, Ahmad Shah Abdali and the Maratha War, which is the third battle of Panipat, is also well known in history that we would understand later. Nadir Shah invaded India in 1739. Ahmad Shah came twice, so 1747 and 1761 were the two periods when Ahmad Shah Abdali invaded India. And Ahmad Shah Abdali actually defeated Marathas in the third battle of Panipat, and that was the period which led to the collapse of the Marathas, and finally you had the British rule that started to establish in India. The next is the War of Succession. Now, War of Succession was very important. Everyone was trying to come to power as a next successor to the prior one, but this brought in financial disturbances. There were political instability, and moreover, the rulers who came in were actually a hierarchical ruler, and they were not well profound with the administrative functions. The next was the policies and the faults in the guidelines laid by Aurangzeb. So Aurangzeb did extreme expenditure. As we had already studied in our last classes on medieval history, we know that Aurangzeb's policy had a major drawback, that he spended a lot of money. And the second important mistake that Aurangzeb did was he had numerous wars with Sikhs and Marathas, and therefore he was constantly neglecting the empire, and this was another major reason which led to downfall of the Mughal empire. And lastly, not the least, was the weak military administration. The equipments were not modernized, outdated equipments and outdated technology was used, and even the navy was not maintained properly. So those were some of the important reasons that led to the downfall of Mughal empire. Now, after Mughal empire, there were numerous small different empires that were established across India. But to summarize, these seven reasons for decline of Mughal empire are extremely important. If you want to remember those closely, the good way to remember it could be, as we said, the successors were weak. Since the successors were weak, they were actually the puppet rulers, so they were always fighting among themselves. They were maintaining relations only on the basis of friendship and conciliation. There was no administrative know-how. The invasions, the foreign invasions, the loots in India were again important. The faulty policies of Aurangzeb, and finally the Jagirdari and the Mansabdari system, which were very, very extremely important, which led to the crisis. Now, as we said, there were rise of various independent states. So there are 9 different heads under which we would understand these, and those are Bengal, the region of Bengal, which includes the present day Bihar and Odisha as well. Then is the region of Hyderabad, this where we have the Kich Kuli Khan, we would understand that later. Then we had region of Awadh, Rohilkhand. Now Rohilkhand is an important region. Rohilas were basically tribes from Afghan, and these tribes established themselves in the region of Uttar Pradesh, the Muradabad and the Bareilly area. Now once they established there at this region, they were constantly taking advantage of the confusion that was created by the Nader Shah's invasion to India. Now, when Nader Shah was invading at that time, the leader of Rohilkhand, the leader of Rohilas, who was Ali Muhammad Khan, established a firm control in Rohilkhand. And as a result, he established his own separate independent state, which was Rohilakhand. So, very important to note, Rohilakhand was a state which was led by Afghan tribe, and it was mainly in the Muradabad and the Bareilly area of Uttar Pradesh. Then we had 6, we would understand that in detail, Jats. Now Jat was a region, the independent state developed in the region of Delhi, Agra and Mathura. So the proximity regions of Delhi. Now here what happened? There were lots of people who were actually working together, and Bharatpur became their capital. So Bharatpur in Rajasthan, present day Rajasthan became the capital of Jats. Now this region or this independent state was led by whom? This was led by Chorman, and later on his nephew Badan Singh came to power. But these two had their influence. The most important influence was the son of Badan Singh, who was Surajmal. So Surajmal's effort are well known to establish Jat state as an independent state. So as we know, the area established from Delhi to Agra to Mathura, Hathras, Rewari, Gurgaon. So all this region, which is close to the present-day NCR and the extensions of the present-day NCR, we can say. Not exactly the present-day NCR, but just to give you a rough idea, the present-day National Capital Region of Delhi and the extension of that to Rewari, to Mathura, Hathras. So that was the area which was under the Jat independent state. So the capital of Jats were again very important, which was Bharatpur. Then we had Rajputs. Rajputs during the 18th century were not that powerful. One of the important contributions of the Rajputs during this time was by Raja Savai Jai Singh. Raja Savai Jai Singh, Jai Singh, so Jaipur was the city which was established, the pink city as we call it. So Raja Savai Jai Singh was the king of Amer. So Jaipur was during that time also known as Amer, and he was the king of Amer. Now Raja Jai Singh was a person who was exceptionally good social reformer, and he was also a scientist. So he built numerous observatories. Most of his observatories were in the region of Varanasi, Mathura, Delhi, Agra, and then Jaipur itself. Then Jantar Mantar was built. So Jantar Mantar was again a milestone of Raja Savai Jai Singh. So those were the contributions of Savai Jai Singh, Raja Savai Jai Singh. Then you had the independent state of Mysore and the Marathas, the hierarchy that followed in Marathas. So all these hierarchies we'll understand one by one. So let's begin with Bengal. As we said, Bengal became an independent state, but this independent state incorporated not just the present-day Bengal, but also Bihar and Odisha. Murshid Kuli Khan was the Diwan of Bengal, and he was assigned this Diwanship by Aurangzeb in 1707. Now, Murshid Kuli Khan was the Subedar of Bengal. He was the Diwan of Bengal, later appointed the Subedar of Bengal by Farrukh Siyar. So, after Aurangzeb, in the initial section, we had understood that it was the Bahadur Shah I, then you had Jahandar Shah and Farrukh Siyar. So in this hierarchy, you had the Mughal ruler who was Farrukh Siyar. And Farrukh Siyar in 1717 said that Murshid Kuli Khan should be the Subedar of Bengal. So Murshid Kuli Khan became the Subedar of Bengal. And finally, the governor. He remained governor from 1717 to 1727. Now Murshid Kuli Khan is known for numerous reforms that were brought, specifically in the field of revenue. Ijara system was introduced. There was reorganization of zamindari, and this was considered as a very good step. People recognized him very well for the efforts for reorganizing the system of zamindari in the regions of Bengal state during that time. He also shifted the capital from Dhaka to Murshidabad. So that was again an important development during his time. And the Ijara system. So Ijara system, shifting of capital from Dhaka to Murshidabad, and reorganization of zamindari. Three were his important contribution. Next to him came Sujauddin. After Sujauddin, we had Ali Wardi Khan, Sirajuddaula, and Mir Zafar. Ali Wardi Khan was one of the best periods of the Bengal state, and during his time there were numerous developments that took place. After him, Sirajuddaula. Now during the time of Sirajuddaula, Battle of Plassey took place, and it was then that East India Company started to shift its role from being just a trader to having a rule in India. So they came as East India Company, but they started to establish British rule, and this was during the time of Sirajuddaula when Battle of Plassey was held. So Battle of Plassey was the main contention point during this period. And however, after Sirajuddaula, there was another puppet ruler, Mir Zafar. Now during the time of Mir Zafar and after Mir Zafar, from 1765, English established their full-fledged control in the regions of Bengal, and there they started this concept of dual government in Bengal, and this was by the efforts of Robert Clive. So by the efforts of Robert Clive, a dual government system in Bengal started. The rule of the leaders of Bengal state came to an end, and finally the English government established their stake. The next year we would understand is the region of Bengal, which we had covered. So the next year is the region of Hyderabad. Now, in the region of Hyderabad, it is important to note that in 1722, Sayyid brothers, as we had understood in our previous lectures, so Sayyid brothers were there so far, and these Sayyid brothers were defeated. Chin Kilich Khan was the main person. He was given the title of Nizamul Mulk by Muhammad Shah, and then he was appointed as the governor of Bengal. He never declared himself as independent, but however, he acted as an independent ruler. He publicly never said he was an independent ruler, but he actually was a independent ruler, right? So what happened was, he started what was known as Asaf Shahi dynasty. So Asaf Shahi dynasty was started by him, and his main idea was to keep out Marathas, but he was highly tolerant to the policies of Hindus. After his death in 1748, so for two decades nearly, this Shahi dynasty came into power, and after him, after his death, his successors were extremely weak. However, the title of Nizam followed. So the next generation followed the title of Nizam, which was the title given to the Marathas as the hereditary rulers. The next is the region of Awadh. Now, Awadh was under Sadat Khan. Again, Muhammad Shah gave Sadat Khan, or made Sadat Khan, the governor, as similar to the regions of Hyderabad, where Chin Kilich Khan was appointed as the governor by Muhammad Shah. Here again in Awadh, Sadat Khan was appointed as the governor. Later on, now the contribution of Sadat Khan is again important. So three contributions similar to the contributions in Bengal, which we had understood for Murshid Kuli Khan. So Murshid Kuli Khan, we had talked about three important contributions in Bengal. Those were the reorganization of Zamindari, the Izara system, and the system where he was establishing himself as a provincial state. Now, here, Sadat Khan again was suppressing the concepts of Zamindar. So, he was reorganizing the Zamindars. His revenue system was again remarkable, similar to Murshid Kuli Khan in Bengal, and he was also known to establish peace in the dynasty. However, his son-in-law, Safdarjung, was in power in 1739, and after his death, there was an independent dynasty which was established. But his son-in-law, Safdarjung, who was Sujat-ud-Daula, was the one who established the most important developments in the region of Awadh. He was known to establish and bring peace and prosperity in the region. So in the region of Lucknow, what is known as Lucknowi culture was introduced. So he established the capital in Lucknow. So Sujat-ud-Daula's work in Awadh is important. He established the capital in Lucknow, and he is also known for his contribution as the bringing in the Lucknowi culture, right? The next important contribution is by Sikhs. Now Sikhs, as we know, they were against the Mughals after the execution of Guru Tegh Bahadur. After Guru Tegh Bahadur was executed by Aurangzeb, Guru Gobind Singh organized the Khalsa, and this was to oppose the wrongdoings of Mughals. Later on, Band Bahadur came to power in 1708. However, he was continuously tortured and finally captured and killed in 1716. After that, the works of Maharaja Ranjit Singh have been very important. Under the works of Maharaja Ranjit Singh, 12 missals or groups which were led by Sikh chiefs were united, and they came together, and the whole area west of Satluj River was established as an independent region or the Sikh territory. Now, this was under the Treaty of Amritsar. This Treaty of Amritsar, which was signed with Lord Minto, was also known as the Treaty of Perpetual Friendship. So, Treaty of Perpetual Friendship was the another name for Treaty of Amritsar, signed with Lord Minto by Maharaja Ranjit Singh. And according to it, officially, the region west of Satluj belonged to the Kingdom of Punjab. After the death of Maharaja Ranjit Singh, English actually gained control over the Sikh province, right? So, the next is the region of Mysore. Now, Mysore was under the rule of Haider Ali. Haider Ali was a soldier from the Mysore army, but he established himself as ruler as in 1761. However, his son Tipu Sultan was the main ruler, and he ruled there for nearly 17 years. He died in Srirangapatnam in the final Anglo-Mysore war, fighting against the Britishers in India. Now, Tipu Sultan was also known as the Tiger of Mysore. The contributions of Tipu Sultan are numerous. The most important one were to modernize the weapons, to modernize navy, to modernize industries in India, and he was highly influenced by the ideas of French Revolution and Renaissance during that time and tried to bring in a liberal thought process in the minds of Indian people. The next was the Marathas. Now, Marathas and the history of Marathas is exceptionally important for you to know. Now, Shivaji established the Maratha kingdom. However, when Shivaji established, it was the rule of Aurangzeb. Shivaji died in 1680, but he was followed by his son Shambhaji. Shambhaji was captured and tortured by Mughal. Then his son came Sahu. Sahu was again imprisoned by Aurangzeb. Now, as Sahu was imprisoned by Aurangzeb, his stepbrother Raja Ram came to power. Then the son of Raja Ram, who was Shivaji III, came to power. Now, Shivaji III was was the ruler, but the actual rule was by his mother Tarabai. When Aurangzeb died, Sahu was released by Bahadur Shah I. When Sahu was released, Sahu and Tarabai had the conflict. Finally, Sahu won the power. But actually, Sahu was not that strong ruler. The actual rule of Sahu during that time, the actual rule was not of Sahu, but of the Peshwa Balaji Vishwanath during that time. So, it was the rule of Balaji Vishwanath, and the real head who became, it was Balaji Vishwanath. So, ultimately in Maratha, the Peshwa Empire or the Peshwa rule came to power. Now, Sahu was weak, and as a result, Balaji Vishwanath, who was the Peshwa? Peshwa means the Prime Minister. Since Balaji Vishwanath was the Prime Minister or the Peshwa, he said that the post of Peshwa should be hereditary. So he saved his hierarchy. That was one thing that he did. The second was he forced the Mughals to restore the territories which were lost by Sahu, and he also fought for the right of Marathas to collect Chauth and Sardeshmukhi. Those were the two taxes. Chauth was one fourth of the revenue. Chauth means one fourth. So, one fourth of the revenue that was collected from the nearby areas of Maratha province by the Marathas, and Sardeshmukhi was one tenth of the revenue collected on the dominoes by the of the region. Now, of the region outside the Maratha. Now, this was the two taxes that were imposed and revenue started to flow in. Later on, after him, there was Bajirao I. Bajirao I remained for nearly 20 years. His empire extended to the regions of South Gujarat, Malwa, Bundelkhand, Hyderabad in the south, and he also captured Celestine and Basin from Portuguese. So, Bajirao I was one of the major rulers during this time, and then his son, Balaji Bajirao. So, Balaji Vishwanath, son of whom was Bajirao I, and son of Bajirao I, the son took the name of grandfather as well as the father. So, he was Balaji Bajirao. So the son was Balaji Bajirao. His powers are important. He shifted the capital from Satara to Pune. And then this was the time of Balaji Bajirao where Maratha power actually became or came to the peak. So Maratha power started to build up during this time. And then there was the most important thing that after Balaji Bajirao, four Peshwas were there. The power was divided into group. And finally, there were Maratha Confederacy. That means five different regions which came together. Those were Peshwas in Pune, Gaikwads in the regions of Baroda, Bhosle from Nagpur, Holkar from Indore, and Sindhias from Gwalior. So five of these regions came together. The region of Pune, Baroda, Nagpur, Indore and Gwalior. As we said, when Bajirao I captured, he extended the regions of Gujarat. Okay, Malwa, which means the regions of Indore. Then Bundelkhand and the close by area. So region close to Gwalior became part of it. And in the south, Nagpur were part of it. So this whole Maratha Confederacy was established. Now these five Maratha political powers that came together had each unit under a Sardar. However, these Sardars were not popular among the people. They looted people, they terrorized people for collection of taxes. Also, they fought among themselves. So there was constant fight among the five confederacies which were established, each under different Sardar. So these five confederacies, which were together the Maratha political power, are important. I repeat again, the Peshwas of Pune, the Gaikwads of Baroda, the Holkar of Indore, Sindhias of Gwalior and Bhosle of Nagpur. So together, each of them under a unit head of Sardar came close to one another, but they were constantly fighting among themselves. They were looting, terrorizing people for collection of taxes. And finally, there was growing financial instability, political instability, which led to the decline and the downfall of the Maratha kingdom. And this was the point where the English Empire started to establish in India. So this was the transition period that we had studied during the late 18th century and how the Mughal power started to decline after Aurangzeb. After Aurangzeb, the successors of Aurangzeb were pretty weak and therefore independent states across India started to grow. As we saw in the initial map, the regions of the region which was under Aurangzeb was a huge big empire. However, later on, his successors started to were actually not that good administrative rulers, and the reasons that we had understood because of their weak succession, because of their growing rivalries, the crisis of Jagirdari, and the weak military administration, the decline of Maratha, the Mughal Empire took place, which led to the independent states, and each of these independent states and their rulers and the hierarchy among those is something that we have discussed in this lecture. In the next lecture, we would understand how British rule started in India and then the India's freedom struggle in the upcoming chapters. So very important part of modern history, which is to begin. Stay tuned for updates. And if you have any questions, any doubts, feel free to post those in the comment section. Thanks for joining in.